Hi, Year 11. It's me again, Mr. Robson. It is 10 to 11 at night. The Apple Pencil has just charged. So why not have a look this time at a paper one? So we're going to have a look at a physical paper. And the important thing for you to bear in mind about your physical paper is that you answer all of the questions. So there is no reduction in this paper. You do all the questions from A and B, and then you do two of the questions from C, and you will have an hour and 30 minutes. Now again, I am not going to spend too much time going through this paper's content, because your revision will help with that. But what I'm going to do is go through the structure of the questions, how this 2020 paper looks, and give you a sense of how I would answer questions. So without further ado, let's make a start. Okay, first question. We've seen one of these before. Bear in mind how you answer them. Which one of the following statements about tropical storms is true? And just work through them one by one, shade one circle. They do not gain energy as they reach land. If anything, they lose energy because they are no longer over the sea. They do not develop over the equator because there are no winds over the equator. That is the doldrum area of the world, so there are no winds. Tropical storms do not occur in high pressure because you need low pressure, air rising. So that means our answer is D, you need ocean temperatures of over 27 degrees. So just your revision here should help you pass these sort of questions. Number two, we have got a bar chart showing the total number of typhoons hitting Japan in 1 year was 204. And all this question wants to know is the percentage of typhoons occurring in August. And you want to give your answer to the nearest whole percentage. So what we do is we look at August, and we can see, if we zoom in, we can kind of figure out that this number here is 69. So what we do with our calculator, because we'll have access to it, we show our working as well. We do 69 divided by the base, which is 204. That will equal, with quite a few different decimals, it will equal something along those lines. And then you times that by 100. Which will bring you to around about 33.8. So you could round it up to 39, and that will do. Show your work in to help guarantee those 2 marks. Give one reason why tropical storms have a seasonal pattern. All you need to do here is just state a reason. So for example, tropical storms will occur, for example, when the seas are warmer. They will occur at that time of year where the seas are warmer. Okay. All right, let's move on. We can see here a figure. Describe the structure of cyclone Idai, shown in figure 2. Now you could make a developed description here, or you could just have 2 descriptive points. If we are having a look at this cyclone, we can see there in the middle, we have got the eye of the storm, which is an area of high pressure where the air is sinking. And you can also see here, we have got that classic spiral winds. So you can mention that. This area also shows the hurricane tail. Again, a classic example of a hurricane. So there's a few things you could have there that you could mention. You can also see, if you look, you can clearly see, if I just change colour, you can clearly see the rain bands here. So you could mention rain bands as well, if you wanted to. There we go. Check me out, check, use my colours now and everything. Let's move on. Right, your first high tariff question, 6 marker. Study figure 3. information about cyclone Idai and its impact on Mozambique. So what you've got here is some really, really nice figure use. Okay, well, really nice figure information. Lots of nice AO1 that you can refer to in your answer. And the question is, if we just zoom in a little bit, the question is suggest why tropical storms have severe primary and secondary effects. Use figure 3, so you must use figure 3 in your own understanding, and it is 6 marks. So what we can see quite clearly here is we've got a before and an after, and we can clearly see that flooding has occurred. That is something you can talk about. And we can clearly see some of that damage there. Here we've got some fantastic primary and secondary effects. 1,300 deaths, 1 million people, over 1 million people displaced. Secondary effect there, cholera. Okay, a very dangerous form of diarrhea broke out. We also know that 80% of Mozambique's population are incredibly poor. There is so much here that you can refer to. Now, when you're considering how to answer this, you want ECS times 2. You want to remember that this is a hidden explain. And to be honest, you probably want a paragraph for this and a paragraph for this. And both of these paragraphs, in a way, need to link to information in figure 3. When you're quoting, take directly quotes from the figure. It's giving you these incredible data sets, so use them in your answer. But just make sure that that stretch links back to your question for that all-important hook. Bear that in mind. You do not need a conclusion for a suggest, but a small one never hurts. So 2 ECS, hidden explain, use the figure directly. When it says show your own understanding, what it means by that is, it means it wants to see plenty of AO2. So you could say, and what you're looking for in that is to use quotes such as, this means that, as a result, in consequence. You're looking for those phrases that force you to explain. Okay? So again, follow through that process. Figure 4, a map showing the distribution of earthquakes in and around Japan. The size of the circle dictates the strength of the earthquake. We've got key cities around here, here, and then we've got plate direction movements and a boundary here. So take your time to pick it apart. Using figure 4, which one of the statements is true? Most of these stronger earthquakes happen on land. Well, if we have a little look, no, they don't. Most earthquakes happen in the east and southeast of Japan. East, southeast, no. Most earthquakes around Japan were over 7 on the Richter scale. It did, I mean, that's looking fairly likely. No earthquakes greater than a 5 on the Richter scale happened to the west. So no earthquakes more than a 5 happened to the west. Well, here's the west. And if we see, if we count this area of Japan around here as the west, because this is the west of the country, this is the east and this is the west, you can clearly see that there are some quite significant earthquakes there. Okay, so I would probably say that the answer here is C. using figure four, name and plate margin. Well, if we look, we have got a Pacific and an Oceanic. And this, this Pacific plate will be subducting underneath this Oceanic plate. Remember, in this motion. So what we have got here is a destructive. Again, your revision is key there. What is another hazard? Volcanoes. So again, this here is literally revision. It's just knowing the spec. That's all that is. Okay, here we go, four marker. So explain how the risks of a tectonic hazard can be reduced. We have got four marks. So we're looking at EC times 2. And explain, all it's looking for is that AO1, AO2. Now there are a few things you can talk about here. A tectonic hazard, usually for us, is a volcano or an earthquake. Now there is no real kind of way to go about this. You could do EC on volcano and then an EC on earthquake. But I would say, actually no, I wouldn't say that. They're both as pretty balanced as each other to talk about. How can you reduce this risk? Well, there are a number of things you can do for volcanoes. Again, I'm not going through all the spec for volcanoes. You can monitor them. You can check river levels in the area for snowmelt. You can use satellites, geostationary satellites, for earthquakes. You can use seismometers. Animals give us warning because they often will become quite agitated before large natural disasters. They're more in tune with nature than we are. And it is a genuine thing that can be used. Remember, you just need to refer to a couple of these and just explain them. So one method is using a seismometer, which checks for seismic waves moving through the earth. This can then be used to warn people. So it's just making sure that in your comment, you're linking that back to how it can be reduced. Okay. You can use satellites to monitor the heat of the land near volcanoes, which allows us to predict when they may erupt, keeping people safe. One source of evidence for climate change during the quaternary period. Again, this is your revision. You could say ice cores, tree rings. There's a few things you can have for this. Again, it's just your revision for this one. Plenty of these in this. Again, all this question is about is reading. Just got to take your time. So let's have a look. The greatest increase in temperature will be along the equator. We can clearly see, and if we look up here, that answer is clearly no, so that's incorrect. Most of Africa will have a rise in temperature between 0 and 0.5. Well, that's these two colours. We can clearly see, nope, that doesn't work. The oceans will show a greater increase in temperature than land areas. Well, if we look here, look. No. So that means our answer here, look, is D. So again, an easy one mark there. Let's move on. Here we'd have an image, but it's copyrighted, unfortunately. And the question is, this. Now, this is quite a big question, so let's have a look at this. Managing climate change involves both reducing the causes of climate change and responding to the change adaptation. Do you agree? Explain your thoughts. Okay. First thing you do, if you're not sure, the first thing you do is you've got to know where you're going to go. So you look at this statement and you have to decide immediately whether you agree with the statement or disagree with the statement. Now, I'm willing to bet the majority of us will probably agree with this statement, that it will involve reducing the cause of climate change, but then also adapting to it as well, responding to it. So what you would do then here is you would say, well, one reason I agree is this. However, some may feel that adaptation is more important because, but I feel they're both important because, or you may be the other way around. Once you know where you're going to go, it helps to keep your answer nice and direct. Okay, because what often happens with students with questions like this is they lose track of where they're going, and then their answers become quite muddled. So it would be ECS times 3. To be safe, I'd say a conclusion as well. And you want your stretch to have that link back, that hook back to the question, using words from the question. Now remember, this is something to bear in mind. In this section here, you may be disagreeing a little bit. You may be saying, well, some people may feel mitigation is more important. With points like this, you're not saying that it's outright wrong. You're not saying that. Be balanced. Just say, for this, for example, well, they're both important. Because they are both important. But some may feel that mitigation is more important. Okay, so you don't have to outright disagree. You don't have to be like, oh, mitigation is useless, adaptation is useless. Be balanced. They're both important, but some may feel that mitigation is more important because we have to stop the root cause of climate change. Remember those connective statements that force you to explain. This means that. Could say furthermore. Consequently, there's lots here you can use to pull this apart. So again, take your time, bear in mind what you need, read the question carefully, and know where you're going to go. Do this if you need to. You won't lose marks for doing this, okay? Do that if you need to help you structure your answers. Spag can also be the use of paragraphs, the way you present your work as well. So try and use paragraphs, okay? Great stuff. Let's keep going. All right, section B, the living world. So, for a small scale ecosystem you have studied, name one producer and one consumer. You want to try and be as specific as you can. So this for us, okay, Slapton Lee. So for example, you could say you could say a pike. For this, you could say algae. So be as specific as you can. Producers, again, your revision is key. All about creating those initial nutrients at the bottom of a food chain or web. So again, your revision is key. All right. Using figure 7, calculate the temperature range in place A, not B. Temperature, not rainfall. So if we have a look at the, and you remember you'll have a calculator, so we find the smallest, which I believe is this one. We find the biggest, which is this one. So you take the smallest from the biggest, and that is your range. Using figure 7, state two differences between the climate shown in A and B. We'll have a little look at the data. What have we got? In A, it receives next to no rainfall all year round, and the temperature is consistently warm all year round. Whereas if we look at B here, they get more rain in the spring months and the autumn winter months, and it warms up in summer. So you could mention any of those down there to get those two marks. Which global system matches the following description? Ecosystem, an area where trees drop their leaves in winter. That is a deciduous forest. Again, revision is key. You'll notice in paper 1, there is a lot of quick fire AO1 and a lot of read the figure and answer. Okay, so just be aware of that. So we've got some copyrighted figures here. Strategies to reduce desertification in the Sahel, which is the almost like the savanna area of Africa. And then strategies to balance the needs of economic development in cold areas. We do not study cold environments, ignore it. We study desertification and deserts. Suggest how different strategies, and different strategies can be used to reduce environmental damage in a hot desert. We do not study cold environments, or do just ignore it. Use figure 8, because that is the desert one, in your own understanding. 6 marks, ECS times 2. Environmental damage in a desert is normally desertification. I mean, guys, they literally give it to you. Look out for clues. That there is a big, big clue. They are basically telling you there, talk about desertification. They're literally giving it to you. So look out for that. Remember, your stretch should link back to that for that hook. And the different strategies, well, you would obviously be able to see them here, but we can't. But to be honest, for 2 ECS, you probably want 2 strategies explained. And for us, I mean, that will likely include afforestation, so planting trees. This is where I spell it wrong. I hope I haven't. Or flat roofs, or maybe intermediate technology, so farmers don't cut down trees anymore. You know, it's just, again, and I'm going to keep saying it, it's all about that revision. The more you revise, the more that these questions will open up to you. So ECS times 2, 2 strategies explained, use the figure, do not do cold. Okay, let's move on. 2.7, give one feature of the pattern of wildfires in Brazil. Well, what we can see if we're given one feature of the pattern, is you could say that they are quite sort of concentrated in patterns, like they're quite close together. You could say that they are actually quite spread out. You can see whilst they are concentrated in areas, they're also very spread out, so you could mention that as well. So just bear that in mind. You just give him one, just one. Let's move on. Outline, one reason why wildfires are a threat to global climate. So outline is just a short explain, so just EC. It's just that short explain. And for us, we're thinking about the pollution they release. When trees are destroyed, it releases carbon back into the air. Trees are no longer available to act as a carbon sink. Again, revision is king. Right, 2.9, I believe this is the final question of two. Yes, it is. So, 9 marks, we're thinking ECS times 3. Some economic activities in the tropical rainforests have major environmental impacts. Do you agree? Explain your answer and use the figure. Now remember, I keep saying this, the first thing you do is you look at this statement, you look at the question, and you decide whether you agree with that statement or disagree with that statement. Now I'm willing to bet, if you look at the question, examiners will design these questions in a way to kind of push you down one route. Come on. I think we can all agree that some activities do have major environmental impacts. I mean, let's just look at them here, look. Yeah. So we're probably going to agree. So you would say, well, yes, they do have major environmental impacts. For example, you could say the dam. But some are quite friendly. For example, ecotourism. However, there is a big impact with things like palm oil farming. And in conclusion, I believe that. So it's all about knowing where are you going to go. ECS, remember, linking back, that S linking back to the question. You need a case study to help explain your answer, which for us is Malaysia. So again, your revision is key. Paragraphs, again, even though there's no SPAG, you should use paragraphs to help divide your work. And you should use the figure wherever you can. In figure 11, I can see a hydroelectric dam in Brazil. This has clearly caused major environmental impacts as the reservoir has destroyed large areas of land behind it, resulting in the deaths of animals, the destruction of trees, which is a major environmental impact. So go through that process bit by bit with it and know where you're going to go. And remember those statements we've been saying. This means that as a result, furthermore, in consequence, however, because you're using those statements to force you to explain. Okay, here we go. You need to do question 3, question 4. You do not do question 5. We have not studied glaciers. We do not study glaciers. So we've got some nice question formats coming up here. And they're quite nice to look at, quite nice to work with. Study figure 12, a map of the British Isles, which is here. I just want to say this is a gorgeous map. I really like this map. And you can see there are letters around the map. All you need to do is figure out which letter matches which box. So an uneven coastline with large islands offshore. Well, if we have a little look, A's coastline is not many islands. B, not many islands. Same with C. The answer for us is probably going to be D. You can see quite a few major islands off this coast. So you'd say D. And then a headland, which marks the coastal limit of the South Downs. Look at your map. The South Downs and the limit are down there. So it's going to be C. So use your map. Read. Please read. Okay, take your time. Okay, again, revision is key. Coastal realignment. So they've just adjusted the shape of the coast. Okay. State what has happened to the area behind the shingle beach, where we can clearly see it's flooded. So say that. One advantage of the coastal management strategy shown in figure 13. Well, again, your revision is key here, but there's a few you can have. It's natural looking. It's cheap. It's low damage. You know, this area is quite simply just farmland. So a few things you could say there. Revision is key. I'm going to keep saying it. Okay. Using figure 14, what is the projected rate of erosion for 2030? So with your ruler, there is probably a way I can do this. But it is too late and I'm not going to try and find it. Using your ruler, just continue the line up. And then the answer, with a much more precise measurement, should reveal itself. So again, take your time. Explain the benefits of hard engineering strategies to protect the coastline. All this is AO1 and 2, and it is EC times 2. And it wants to know about hard engineering. So for example, you would say a seawall, or gabions, or rock armour, or groins. So you would just pick two of them and just say, what are their benefits? That's it, just what are their benefits? So you could just say a benefit of a seawall is that it is long lasting. And, you know, you'd offer a bit of explanation into that. They're strong structures built to last. An example of a groin is they use natural processes. They stop longshore drift. So again, it's all about that revision and knowing what constitutes hard engineering. Just bear that in mind. Let's go on. Oh, actually, before I do move on, those statements do still work. This means that, consequently, as a result, all this still applies. Okay, figure 15, we have got a gorgeous headland and bay structure here, and a nice diagram showing you basically the before and after here. And you can clearly see erosion has occurred here. And deposition has occurred here to get our beach. Right, there is so much to look at here, but let's look at the question. Ah, right. Explain the formation of physical features shown in the coastline in figure 15. ECS times 2, but so you know, like two developed points. My word, year 11, there is so much you could talk about here. You could talk about the beach. you could talk about the headland. You could talk about the whole bay. You could talk about, because it is there, you just can't see it. You could talk about the wave cut platforms. There is a lot you can talk about here. There really is. So take the time to pull the picture apart and then pick two. So for example, you might be really confident with beach. So you explain how that forms using figure 15. And you might be really confident with the headland and bays, which you should kind of use together. Like headlands and bays kind of come together, like pie and chips. You got to use them together. Or maybe more fish and chips. I don't know. It's late. Anyway, there you go. So, again, take your time. Just read it carefully. This is a lovely question, this. Okay. And even though I say ECS times two, with this one, the structure you're looking for really is that firstly, this happens. Secondly, this happens. Thirdly, this happens. And finally, you get a beach. Do you know what I mean? So this kind of still applies. It is two developed paragraphs. But within that paragraph, you're probably using that process structure there. Okay. That nice process structure. Okay. So really quickly, I would maybe say, for example, firstly, the bay is further back from the ocean or the sea, meaning that waves slow down as they enter. Secondly, as they slow down, they begin to deposit due to increased friction. Thirdly, the accumulation of sand leads to the formation of a long constructive beach. Just follow the process. Okay, rivers. Same map, but with letters in different places. A river that flows west into the Pennines, or from the Pennines into Liverpool Bay. Look at your letters, Liverpool Bay. So the answer is C. And a river which flows northeast through the Fens into the Wash. Find the Wash. Skeggy's there. The answer is clearly D. Two easy peasy marks. Move on. Okay, use figure 17. Describe the relief, the height and shape of land on either side of the straightened river. Well, what you can see is it is very flat. Okay, and it is very wide. It is flat, wide land. Suggest how the strategy shown in figure 17 helps to manage the river. Well, what channel straightening does is it speeds up the flow of water to get it out of the area quicker, so there's less chance of it flooding. When water flows around these meanders, it slows down. It can't discharge as quickly and it floods. It overtops and floods. So the idea is it speeds up the flow. There we go. Okay. Use figure 18, calculate the range. So it is just that biggest, take smallest. It's getting late now, I need to go to bed. And so yeah, again, easy marks. And look at this, one mark there, two marks here. You know, that is three easy peasy marks. And I'm not even going through the rest of the easy marks. We've probably come across at least 10 to 15 really straightforward marks up to now. So just bear that in mind. All right then, 4.5. Explain. So all it's wanting is AO1 and AO2, how river levees are formed. Now this is a process question. okay, I know your mind will be going EC times 2, and you're not wrong, but this is a physical process question, a bit like this. So you want to use the process model. Firstly, secondly, thirdly, you're going through that process. Remember, I'll very quickly go over this. A river levee is when a river floods and creates raised banks either side with large sediment closer to the river and smaller sediment the further away you go. Okay. So yeah, again, that revision is key. That revision is absolutely key. With this sort of question, be sure to read it carefully. Yes, I know that this would be EC times 2, but this is a physical paper and this is a process question. It just wants to know how something is made. So you follow this structure, really. Firstly, secondly, thirdly. Fourthly, finally. Just follow that process. Right, I think we might be nearly there. In fact, I think we might be, yes. So here we go. Study figure 19. Information about Cockermouth and the impact of Storm Desmond in 2015. Again, we've got some nice AO1 there. Explain how physical and human factors may affect flood risk. Figure 19 in your own understanding. All right, let's just look at this question here. This question is not a process question. You are not telling me how something is formed. So for this, ECS times 2 would work here. Now, if we have a look, we've got some nice physical factors in here. Heavy rain. It's at the meeting point of two rivers, a confluence. The area around it is steep. And then we've got a nice human factor. There's a lot of urbanisation in the area. Impermeable concrete drains. So what you're looking to do, you are looking to explain two ECSs, one for physical, one for human. So for example, in your physical paragraph, you may well mention, for example, the steep land. And you may well mention the confluence, or you might just do one. In the human paragraph, you may well mention the concrete point and the drain point. You might mention both, you might just mention one in detail. It's whatever you think works best for you. You do not need a conclusion for this. And remember those points here. This means that, and so on. All right, I appreciate this has been quite a long video. So again, once you have reached the glacier bit, you go nowhere near it. At this point, you are done. So, when you are reviewing the rest of your paper, you check those small markers first, in particular ones like this, where it is all about reading. All about the reading, okay? About taking your time and looking at the resources that you have got to hand. And they're also the ones that you will rush. Once you have gone through and you have checked your small tariff questions, look at your large questions and be clear, have you stretched and hooked back? And that's a very easy thing to see. You look at your final points and you're looking and thinking, well, has it stretched back? That hook is important. That hook is really important because it shows your examiner that you're thinking about the question. Right, I think it might be time to finish the video there. So this has been a walkthrough of paper one, 2020. Again, the importance of revision is key here, but we've seen lots of different types of question here, lots of different styles of question that you will get. I hope this helped. The pencil worked, which is great. And yeah, come find me if you need me. Thank you very much, everybody.